All right, just so you know, this content is for education and facilitating self-empowerment. However, this platform exists to cultivate an addictive and abusive codependent relationship with a vapid materialist pop culture, while data scraping algorithms sync your personal metadata onto pattern maps used to anticipate, then invert emergent trends in our collective evolution of consciousness in an effort to compromise our ongoing mass awakening. So there's that. Disciples are students and stay close to the teacher. Jesus had 12 disciples, then replaced Judas, making 13 altogether. Apostles, on the other hand, are initiates in that they are charged with teaching and spreading the gospel, no longer disciples or students if they ever were, like St. Paul. Luke 10 recounts the story of the 72 apostles whose names are written in the heavens, according to Christ. They're sent out in groups of 2x2 with abilities of exorcism, healing, and ministering, given to them by Jesus himself. One of the most popular criticisms of Christianity coming out of atheists and materialists media is that it is just another form of paganism, and that there's just pagan symbolism all over Christianity because the story of Jesus is a pagan remix of previous deities. And much of academia that supports this illusion does so not so much with presenting false information, but exaggerating the similarities and then kind of obfuscating the differences. And at the core of one of those concepts is the idea that Christ kept 12 disciples closer to him because they clearly didn't follow his path, understand his parables, and then they deceived him, including Peter and Judas, who are symbolically foreseen to denounce or leave Christ and betray him. So I'll get into that in just a little bit. But there's a circle of 12 disciples surrounding Christ. It reminds me of the clock, but it also reminds me of the idea that Christ is one at the center of what becomes 13. And the first letter is A, 13th letter is M, so the I am speaking to you. Maybe it's time to make the donuts. It's time to make them go nuts. We've got 13 as the baker's dozen. I think of 12 as a dozen, baker's dozen. And then we've got the dozen is do zen. You just separate that, do zen. And zen, we have these enigmatic paradoxical teachings that remind Christians of either the Gospel of Thomas or the Q document or the parables, the enigmatic teachings of Christ that kind of require a little bit of, it's a little bit of a cognition pump that encourages the physician to heal thyself. And in Luke 10, we have the introduction of the 72. Now, I'd like to point out that the Zen Koan, that's a homophone for Koan, a Hebrew word for teacher. So Christ is a Koan of cones, coming through light cones, possibly. So we've got physics and Zen and Hebrew eschatology embedded in an esoteric teaching. And I'll point out that the esotericist Hellenized Jews were sounding rather Gnostic in the century or two before Christ. So we've got the 72 sent by in 2x2, that's groups of four. So we have apostles and disciples. And disciples are sent out into the desert in Luke 9, and then Jesus has to go out into the desert with them and feed the 5,000. And that's an esoteric teaching I'll break down in a separate video. But the disciples go out into the desert, doesn't go so great. The 72 go out, they come back. We'll get into it. But in Mark 4, we have Christ saying to the disciples, the 12, do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables? And then he explains the parable, and there's some seed sown on rocky ground, and that's a reference to the rock, or Cephas, Peter, the cornerstone of the Catholic Church, which is a pagan institution that worships the Antichrist. And then we have another teaching here that there's those who will, when trial, tribulation and persecution arise on account of the word, they fall away. There's some seed that is sown amongst thorns, and that's the crown of thorns that Judas wanted. And because of the world of deceitfulness of riches, then they, those thorns come in and they choke. So that's Judas choking himself with the noose, hanging himself. And he wanted that crown of thorns. Again, the cross of St. Peter right in your face in the Catholic Church. I mean, they have to put it in your face. They're not allowed to keep it backstage. In Christianity, well, in Eastern and in the Catholic Church, we've got the cross of St. Peter. Now, the story goes St. Peter was hung upside down. I mean, it had to happen. Look at the Caravaggio. I mean, it looks pretty realistic, right? Now, in pop culture, we associate the upside-down cross through horror movies and heavy metal music and whatnot with Satanism. And Peter, the Petra, the Cephas, the seed sown in the rock when, he denounces Christ three times. He's the only disciple that Jesus compares to Satan. He doesn't even compare Judas to Satan, but he does Peter. But both of those disciples who are a disappointment, disappointed disciples, you were appointed, now you're disciple. You're pulling your eyelid down. That's a Japanese symbol. We'll get into that later. This particularly Valentinian Gnostic take on early Christianity is embedded in the fabric of reality, and it's embedded in the varied nature of the carbon-based life form in which God breathed life. We have the dust and the breath, and the breath had both spirit and humidity, or water. Now carbon, stable carbon, has 6 protons, 6 electrons, 6 neutrons, and that is a pen that is mightier than the word or the sword. Or maybe the sword is words. It's an anagram. Maybe it's the same thing rearranged. We'll get into that. We'll talk about that. I am, as in IAM. I am radioactive. That's uranium, and that's UR. Ani, UM. That's the poppy iris of Ani. UNIM. I'll get into that later. We've got uranium-236 embedding the mathematical problem 2 36s, or 2 times 36, which is 72. And that's the 72 sent out into the desert. So we have mythopoetic patterns that map onto Christ sending the message out into the desert to bring the water of life into the harrowing of hell. But we also have the flip side. So there's like a mirror image, and one side you've got water, on the other fire. There's kind of this coincidence or polar opposites that are in tension with one another that are embedded in the, well, a lot of the mythologies of the world. It's not so Zoroastrian and bipolar, though. It's kind of dynamic, in which we're in a middle ground or purgatory where these two forces are kind of playing out, and you're in a spiritual way station undergoing some sort of correction. Becoming perfectly imperfect or good enough. Anyway, it's kind of a game, and there's some radioactive uranium in the desert. The depleted uranium is depleting the human DNA and causing diminishing returns. So we have this idea of the breaking of the atom, the nuclear, and then we have Adam in the garden getting broken open, and then the female emerging, in which he gets into a fiasco with, and then we have the we've got the piercing of Christ on the side and the ripping of the temple veil during the crucifixion. This is all symbolism of the same mythopoetic pattern that speaks to, among other things, particle physics embedded in Christian scripture. And we're entering into a new era. And there's that HOH. The 3 days of harrowing of hell reminds me of Genesis 3:24. 24 hours in a day. 3:24 is 72 hours. It was St. Paul who was out of it for 72 hours, and the scales fell from his eyes, and then he saw the fractals. And then we've got also the harrowing of hell and embeds water coming into Tartarus. So the Tartarians had that mud flood because the water and breath hit that dust, and we were baking in hell and hiding from the sun, and then the water of life comes down during the harrowing of hell. That's some interesting stuff there. So we have Christ embedded in the Christian art, which is inspired with the same co-creative spirit that inspired scripture could be inspired by. So we're looking at mythopoetic patterns in Christian art and scripture that map onto biological chemistry these guys weren't supposed to know about. And there's gals as well. We talk about disciples and apostles. The disciples might have been a bit of a disappointment, but I'll remind you, St. Paul makes reference to a number of apostles that are sent out. So some of those 72 are named, but it's only a few of them. But one of them, Junia, is a woman. So there is a female apostle. So we think of 12 disciples and then the apostles and, you know, I'm over here just a warrior in the garden biding my time, but we're waiting for a cultural and scientific renaissance where the overlap between the spiritual concepts and the scientific concepts are, someone like me who has Sophia or wisdom on my side is allowed to speak on these things. This number 666 isn't evil. It talks about the nature of the merging of the flesh with the spirit in the water of life. And we have in that pattern of the 2x2 or 4 sent out, we have 18 groups of 4, and that's 3 days. That's how long it takes to build the temple and take it down again, according to Christ in the Gospel of John. And he's talking about the body. It's also embeds carbon physics. We have two worlds colliding and then creating that what Albert Schirer coined the vesica pisces. That's a bit of a joke about slicing open a fish bladder. That's a he wasn't a Christian. Anyway, it's the mandorla or the almond was the original name that was given to that particular shape by the mathematicians and symbologists. Anyway, we have something of a Ptolemaic world embedded in something like a gobstopper citrus fruit model of the particle physics, which maps onto other patterns that we find in molecular biology on a larger level. And then on an even larger cosmological level, we can see these patterns playing out in middle Platonic concepts about cosmology and the Ptolemaic model. So we have different ideas of something like the flat earth surrounded by the hemisphere firmament or a globe in the center of a cosmogony that looks something like this footage here from Minute Physics that shows you what the actual model looks like. We're used to that simplified overlapping ellipses with a little, you know, cluster of dots in the middle. But what we actually have looks more like a gobstopper or a torus, like a donut. And these little particles represent where an electron could potentially be. So the outer edge of that donut, where the sprinkles and jimmies are, that's the covalent bonds that leave the four corners of those four covalent electron bonds in carbon. And so in a carbon atom, it looks something like this right here. And you've got in the center, you've got your protons and neutrons, and then you've got an inner circle of electrons, and there's going to be two electrons in that inner circle. And then on those four corners, you've got your four covalent bonds. And that maps onto a baseball and an atom and Ptolemaic cosmology. And I kind of see the shape of that, the generic classic space helmet. So, you know, NASA has embedded the cosmology of the universe, the atom, and Homer's Odyssey donut right there in the particle physics of the space helmet. So I don't know what NASA's up to. It looks like, you know, maybe they're doing something else. Maybe they're doing inner space and we're looking at outer space. Things tend to be a little backwards. 6 is 9, so maybe those jimmies are going to the center. We're in Munchkin land. If we're going to Dunkin' Donuts, that little ball at the center is the Munchkin. And then you got the Taurus around the center. So maybe, you know, the Admiral Perry's and the other, what's Admiral Byrd? Who's the Hollow Earth guy? Maybe if you're trying to get into the Munchkin land of Oz in the middle, it's backwards. Anyway, we do have this idea of Hades and Sheol being a world that is in between, or something of a bardo. And we have the carbon-based life form embedded to have been specifically designed to live here and carry the spirit for a certain amount of time. Also, a classic 72 years is a classic human lifespan. It's also one half of the number 144, which might be significant, particularly to the Jehovah's and people who pay attention to the Book of Revelation. And I'm talking about, you know, symbolism from Revelation that is said to require Sophia, or wisdom. So we're told that we've got the number 666 as the number of the man and the beast. And I'm suggesting that opening that up and breaking up that code is kind of like opening Pandora's box. So, yeah. Sorry, not sorry?
I bought a donut and they gave me a receipt for the donut. I don't need a receipt for a donut. I'll just give you the money. You give me the donut. And the transaction. We don't need to bring ink and paper into this. I just cannot imagine a scenario where I'd have to prove that I bought a donut. Some skeptical friend, don't even act like I didn't get that donut. I got the documentation right here. Oh wait, it's back home in the fire, under D, for donut. We all know what D is. I like baked potatoes, man. I don't have a microwave oven. It takes forever to cook a baked potato in a conventional oven. Sometimes I'll just throw one in there, even if I don't want one. But by the time it's done, who knows? I throw a potato in and go on vacation.
So what if I told you maybe we're kind of like Mitch Hedberg's vacation potato, waiting for Schrodinger to open up the microwave and see what condition his pet talking head Mr. Potato is in. And kind of like Lazarus, who spent 4 days in the underworld when everyone else does three. Paul, Adam and Eve on Genesis 3:24, there's another 3 days embedded in the harrowing of hell of Christ. So maybe we're waiting for Barry Covalent Bonds to knock 72 out the park.
Pride myself too, life of a dawn, lights keep blowing, coming in the club with that fresh shit on, with something crazy on my arm, and here's another hit, Barry Bonds.
So we've got the pan, or the proton and neutron labyrinth of that inner circle, which maps onto that purgatorio of the overlapping worlds looking like that Vesica Pisces, which is not entirely unlike the ellipse of the flat world in the Ptolemaic hemispheric covered model we have here, with the Sheol or underworld on the other side of a world that is covered by a hemispheric dome and the firmament. Now we've got that the baker's dozen of the 13, and then the 72 apostles would make 85 people sent out. Christ sends out the 12 into the desert and they end up feeding everybody pizza. That's the feeding of the 5,000. So we've got 12 and 1 and 72 for 85. Then add Mary the mother, Mary Magdalene, why not? Prominent women in the story here. And then we have the beloved that may be Lazarus, and the beloved may be you or me, symbolically. And that would be 88. That's the number of constellations in the firmament that shows his handiwork. And that structure is not unlike a baseball. You ever crack a baseball open? That's like Pandora's box of string theory. You're not going back after you see that. You get a peek inside there of the Barry, the covalent bonds. Everything's backwards or inwards. So, Anyway, inner space is outer space is inner space. Having your name written in the heavens might mean, well, that's what Christ tells the 72 that go out and come back. He says, don't be so crazy about having control over the demonic spirits. Be fortunate that your name is written in the heavens. The four-letter name of God, or the tetragrammaton, is set up like bowling pins. I'm reminded of the Christ-like dude who's kind of living the life of Brian, mistaken for the the Big Lebowski. Yah is the short name for Yahweh in the Old Testament. It shows up 46 times. Its numerical value is 26. That is a 72. In the Quran, Surah 72 is all about the jinn, and that's the jinn spirits that come down and then fill in a vessel. Those are the beings or the fallen angels that didn't keep to their realm. Adam and Eve might be something like that, or a polar opposite, the mirror. And 324 reminds me of 3 days. So Adam and Eve die for what they did in the garden, or they are brought to life. And so they end up spending this spell of harrowing of hell. We have the ruddy man or the red man, the Adam, who's been able to blush. He's put on a green face here. That's the coincidence of opposites we see in the Salvator Mundi, which embeds precognition of Jeff Tweedy lyrics and COVID, among other things. Then we've got, well, there's a secret in Mona Lisa I've shown everybody. She cries lightning. The Mona Lisa's smile has been commented on by art historians, but no one showed you Mona Lisa's tears until now. There's the stigmata of Christ and Adam, represented in the 324 Genesis artwork. That is also Luke 16. So that's the Luke 16 chapel, not the Sistine chapel. Then we have, of course, the infamous Albrecht Dürer overlays of the crucifix, which embeds knowledge of, among other things, a malignant spirit and panpsychism emerging in 2021, and then living a short life and dying. We've got the Donald Trump campaign with their Phrygian magi hats of the cult of Mithras that popped up again in the French Revolution. They're embedded in Goya's painting of, well, among other things, draining the Swamp Thing 150 years before Swamp Thing is a DC Comics character. We have Marvel comic book characters and other comics characters, and even that red Phrygian cap embedded as the mind of God, the revolutionary. So the solar god is a revolutionary. So that magi cap of the Phrygians, or the red cap, and the red mind of God is embedded here, as well as a cape around Noah. That means there's Noah's cape. Yeah, there's Noah's cape. I've mentioned before, particularly in, I believe, the alphabet code, how I've seen how the Holy Spirit can inspire the evolution of human consciousness and the development of etymology, so that we can kind of look back at scripture and see how some of it is inspired to embed symbolism, science, and even modern day colloquialisms that wouldn't be known to the people that wrote the scripture, but certainly could be edited in there by the force which literally helps us navigate the evolution of our collective consciousness. Now we have Christ standing on the X, marks the spot in the center of all creation, merging two worlds together. This is the two orders of creation that are mediated by the healer, Christ, a warrior in a garden, a gardener in a war, and Christ is symbolically shown kind of like in a UFO. We're kind of like Lazarus in the fourth day in the tomb, and Christ leaves the harrowing of hell after spending 3 days. He says in the Gospel of Thomas, "There will be times when you look for me and won't find me." So there is literally, there's esoteric language that suggests that Christ is a physical phenomenon, but also something of a mediator that brings you into a spiritual realm. And this traveling from one spiritual realm down into the physical world is embedded not just infamously in Genesis 6, but also in the 12 spies. So in this story, Moses sends out, in Numbers 13, 12 spies from Israel into Egypt. And this is a move from beyond the firmament down into the physical world. So what this means is for the spies are like spirits or shadow people or jinn or demons, and they come down as like fallen angels and embody physical people. Yeshua and Caleb are the only two spies who bring back a good report and believed God would help them succeed. They're people that maintained the faith while during something that's not entirely unlike the 40 days quarantine in the desert, or the 3 days in the harrowing of hell. So bringing water to the desert, or having faith in something felt but not seen, is something that Joshua and Caleb do here. Joshua, or Yeshua, is known as a fierce warrior. Caleb, I'd like to point out, is an anagram for C. Bale, or Christian Bale, who plays Bruce Wayne, as well as Moses and some other characters. He's a bit of a shapeshifter career-wise, and he's also known for being in the United Kingdom, but also portraying Americans very convincingly. He was pretty good in Ford versus Ferrari. He even played a crackhead from Eastern Massachusetts, and you couldn't tell that he was Batman the whole time. Anyway, Yeshua, that's the name of the sixth book of the Jewish Bible, but we don't talk about what happens after five, right? Hold up your hand. That's five. Now hold up one. Now make a cave with the five. And insert the one. That's 5 + 1 = 6. So throughout all of human creative output is a kind of universal myth that unfortunately Joseph Campbell kind of hinted at and then fucked right up. So yeah, everyone got a bad introduction to that story. So we've got men in makeup. That's men in eyeliner. Put eyeliner on him. That's Elohim. So we've got the Pharaoh moans and the whore moans and the pretty boys going to war. Who does she want, Bruce or the prince? Right? Bruce or the prince? Anyway, show me all the blueprints. The sad prince. The blue prince or the blue Bruce? So, what am I talking about? Mythopoetic symbolism from the Old Testament getting scrambled by the Coen brothers in Exodus. Oh, I'm sorry, not in Exodus. That's in the Big Lebowski. And in Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? It's Ridley Scott that does the scrambling of the Christian symbolism in Exodus, where we have Jesus from the Lebowski playing the Pharaoh. And we have a story about the Pharaoh moans and the whore moans. And this is where things kind of get disturbing. We've got the Jesus, the pedophile from the Big Lebowski. He's wearing his royal purple, decked out in his, he's got his guitar pick here, and he's going to play the guitar. And there's the blue balls waiting for the second coming. There's no ring on his middle finger because nobody fucks with the Jesus, because we're told here that Jesus is the property of the anti-Jesus. The prince of this world is the dark prince, who's literally licking the planet symbolically there, or at least the gods of war, the red planet. So we have Jesus, or Jesus, the Hispanic pedophile, and he's setting them up and knocking them down. And he's known for really knowing how to take down that 72 Pythagorean tetractus. The disturbing symbolism here is something of a reference to Jim Croce's song Time in a Bottle. And we have right in your face Johnny Five, the AI, blinded by the lights. We don't notice what's behind the Johnny Five AI symbolism of this old school lamp. We're kind of at a retro bowling alley, maybe not too retro in the mid 90s when this was filmed. So we've got Jim Croce, Time in a Bottle, sitting right there behind Johnny Five. And inside a bottle, it looks like, that kind of looks like Han Solo, trapped in carbonite there. So we got the carbon-based life form, Han Solo, the Solo hand. Then we've got the glove on the hand, kind of like Michael Jackson. We got the Jackson 5. We got the Johnny 5, so we got the Johnny Jackson 5 here. We've got Liam up front, and then we got the second Antichrist Jesus with the Space Ghost glove on. And Johnny 5 looking like artificial intelligence. And I should point out once again that Johnny 5 is E.T. and Alien Invasion is A.I. And Al Gore was born 9 months after the Roswell incident and has on camera taken credit for developing the internet. That all may not be of little circumstance. Let's get back to Johnny Five at the bowling alley. And these are the bowl judgments. So that's Jesus knocking them down. Yeah.
You know, who's your favorite basketball player?
Magic Johnson.
Who's your favorite movie star?
Eddie Murphy.
Who's your favorite rock star? Prince. You're a Prince
fan. Boss, Bruce.
Prince.
Bruce.
Fucking Santana. That creep can roll, man.
Yeah, but he's a pervert, dude.
Yeah.
No. He's a sex offender with a record. He did 6 months in Chino for exposing himself to an 8-year-old.
Huh.
When he moved to Hollywood, he had to go door to door to tell everyone he was a pederast.
What's a pederast, Walter?
Shut the fuck up, Donnie.
Whoever dehydrated those pirates could not have foreseen their accidental rehydration with the heavy water we use in recharging the atomic pile. You saw it yourself, Robin. The slightest impact was sufficient to instantly reduce them to antimatter.
No, Robin. No. It's not for mortals like us to tamper with the laws of nature.
Let that be an object lesson in the dangers of tampering with the laws of Mother Nature.
United World Organization.
Precisely, Robin.
So we can see that 666, the carbon atom, the splitting of the atom, the breaking up of a whole into these polarized opposites, and then the recontextualization and reintegration or balancing of those opposites is something of a pattern we see embedded in world events as well as the human condition. And we're coming out of an era where we just went through a massive kind of like global Mother Earth Munchausen by proxy abuse on behalf of a hive mind that locked us indoors and tried to convince us we were really sick and fucked up and made us put masks on. I mean, the Munchausen by proxy is kind of trending, so I think of that as a symptom of the sickness of the age and representing of what I call the spirit of the age. So we're spitting out these carbon atoms, that's 666, the satanic number, or so we thought happens to be actually the number of carbon-based life forms. And it looks like this planet and water and sunlight are specifically engineered to make us comfortable. We air-breathing mammals. So what we're doing to this Earth is raping it so that we can feel better because we're waking up to what we've been doing, which is kind of worshiping ourselves and raping the Earth and then kind of shitting on the one thing that helped us get out of our predicament. It was the anti-paganism of divine sovereign personhood that disrupted the communist hive mind of the paganisms of the era, which is why the pagan leader of Constantine slaughtered Christians and took over their system. Now, I'm someone that works with wisdom. Here is Sophia, let him that has understanding count the number. 600, 666. I've pointed out how 600, 60, that's 60, 3 times 20, and 6, write those out, that's 600,606, which is a pictographic icon with 600K and 60 and 6. So that's book and 360, or book and 66. I'll show you how this maps onto the 66 chapters of the King James Bible. And we've also got 3 score embedding that COVID quarantina in the desert of 40 days. And 320 is also March 2020 in shorthand. And that's the month when we began those quarantina lockdowns. Quarantina being 40 days also kind of maps onto a fractal here. We have 30 days in a month, 40 days in the quarantina. We have the 3 days of the harrowing of hell, but the 4 days in the tomb of Lazarus, and something was stinking in there when Jesus got Lazarus out of there. So there seems to be some interesting symbolism that we're kind of you know, going through a cycle. There's three on and one off, and we're kind of in the one off waiting for the cycle to restart, or we're in the harrowing of hell waiting for Christ to come back with a little more water of life and give us a little refresh. And I've talked about how the modern parlance and common colloquialisms of our modern time can be embedded in scripture written a long time ago. Also, under my understanding that this world is kind of consciousness-based, I guess God could just change his mind and rewrite the fabric of history. So I guess there's that too, but, you know, living in that world gets kind of unstable and chaotic. I don't want to imagine that. We do have 600,000, 606 embedded in that number. And of course, 600K is book. And this seems to suggest that the scripture in Revelations embeds a code that isn't just about carbon-based life forms and the carbon climate change, the cultural climate change of the hive mind, but it also seems to predict the 66 books within the King James Holy Bible. That's the 39 books of the Old Testament, the 27 of the New Testament, totaling 66. Now, there's actually 88 in the Ethiopian Bible, and I think of the 88 being the constellations, maybe. Starvin' Marvin Martian isn't starving for food for thought. Now, if you look at that 60 and 6, and then you view that plus sign askew, then what we have is 60 times 6. So we have the 600K, or the book, and then 60 times 6 is 360. It just goes on and on and on, right? The end meets the beginning. And then 60 plus 6 is 66. Now take a look at 600, 60, and 6 written out. We've got three sixes. And then if you look at it a little askew there, you see three zeros. Now look at 360 and 66. That's three sixes and then a three and a zero. Interesting how there's kind of a fractal repeating nature embedded even in some of the number ciphers encoded in there. So you can take a look at that number, 600, 366, till the cows come home. I'm going to break it down some more, but that's about as far as I go for now. As you can see, it goes on and on and on. That book keeps repeating itself, but it repeats itself in our other modern mythologies, and I continue to break that down. You can hit me up at patreon.com/Bickford to get exclusive content and go deeper down some of those rabbit holes. Thanks for coming out. Good night. God bless.
Prince.
Bruce.